So good morning to all of you. So myself, Dr. P. Raja, Associate Professor, College of Horticulture and Forestry, and the Associate Nodal Officer of this IDP Nagpur project. Under this project, we are conducting series of coaching classes for the students of BSc Horticulture, Agriculture, and Forestry. And today we will have this more specialization on this vegetable science. On this occasion, I would like to thank our DI, Dr. S. Basanta Singh sir, for continuous support and encouraging and the students to attend this GRF coaching class. And on this line, we could invite a very profound, renowned personalities and all over the India. And they are many resource person. They are agreed to give the coaching class for our students on this occasion. So make use of it, this wonderful opportunity to interact with this. And also I would like to thank our Dean, Professor B.N. Hazarika sir. He's a nodal officer of IDP Nagpur project. So he's continually supporting us to conduct this class for the benefit of our BSc Horticulture student. And so I welcome Dr. A.V.V. Kaunia, so Scientist to Vegetable Science, ICAR, CTCRI, Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala. So Dr. Viswanath Kaunia is more specialized in horticulture and vegetable science. So he will be delivering these lectures on vegetable science. Dear students, I know there's a lot of uncertainty in the internet and the remote areas. So for you, we are recording in the YouTube. Please share with your friends and take notes, because we could get very good personalities for our coaching class. So please make use of this time. Those who are joined in Zoom, if you have any queries, any doubts, you can ask. Make use of this time and the resource person. So now may I request Dr. Viswanath Kaunia to start the lecture. Yes, please.
First of all, I would like to say thank you to the Dean, College of Horticulture and Forestry, Pasigat, and to the Nodal Officer, Dr. Raja, for giving me this opportunity. Actually, vegetable science is a very broad subject, we know. So I will be covering the entire vegetable science in two parts. Today, we will go with the first part. And as for the JRF horticulture, we have to read all. Fruit science, vegetable science, post-harvest, and everything. But fruit science and vegetable science cover the most questions in the examination. Every year, the standard of the exam is increasing. 10 years ago, when I was writing the JRF exam, the reading of the some objective books which are available in the market, that would be enough. But I have been observing, and every year the standard is increasing. And now ICAR has handed over the responsibility of the conducting the examination to NTA, National Testing Agency. So I have gone through the last year the JRF questions of horticulture, plant breeding, and other subjects. So the standard has been tremendously increased, and some questions which are even above the level of BSc students have also been asking in that question papers. So in this lecture, I will try to cover each topic or crop by crop, and I will avoid all common things. One specific things only I will focus. And so now I will start my presentation. So in this class, I will cover solanaceous, leguminous, carnivorous vegetables and biotechnology part. And these are the vegetables that form the major part, and all these are warm season vegetables except some leguminous vegetables. So we all know what comes under the solanaceous vegetables: tomato, brinjal, chili, long pepper, bell pepper, and potato. Earlier, tomato was Lycopersicum esculentum, you all might be knowing, but few years ago it has been changed to Solanum lycopersicum. Earlier, Miller, he separated the tomato from the Solanum genus because of the presence of Ricinus canals and longitudinal anther dehiscence. The anther dehiscence in the tomato is longitudinal, whereas all members of the Solanaceae family have porous anther dehiscence. That means anther dehisce at the top of the top portion. But in case of tomato, the anthers dehisce longitudinally, vertically downwards. So based on the two regions, earlier Miller, he separated the tomato from the genus Solanum and he established a new genus Lycopersicum esculentum. But recently again tomato was added to the genus Solanum and it was changed to Solanum Lycopersicum. Among all the solanaceous vegetables, all are fruit bearing vegetables except potato, where potato is a tuber bearing solanaceous vegetable. And leguminous vegetables, these are the leguminous vegetables we are commonly grown in India and other countries. Field pea, garden pea, beans, French bean, garden bean, cluster bean, wing bean. And you all might be knowing the botanical names of all the vegetables. So we will not much focus on the botanical names. And cucurbitaceous vegetables, these are the largest group of vegetables that are being cultivated. And almost we have more than 15 vegetables belongs to the family Cucurbitaceae. Are being cultivated in India as well as abroad also. So I have given only few botanical names. You all may be knowing the botanical names, no? So one Malvaceae vegetable, there is only one vegetable in the family Malvaceae, that is Ochra abelmaspis esculentus. It is a polyploid, amphidiploid. We will see what is the polyploid and what is amphidiploid in the upcoming slides. So geographical origins. Every crop has one particular origin, and from that part it has been migrated to the other parts of the world by humans, through human migrations. So you all may be knowing the origins of all the crops, like your teachers might have taught you origins of all the crops. You have to know the origins of all the crops, and here I have given only few based on the introduction into the India. Because few years ago there was a question in JRF examination. The question was, when was tapioca introduced into India? 17th century tapioca was introduced. So I have made some collections of other crops when they were introduced into India. Tomato was introduced in 19th century, chili in 16th century, potato in 17th, French bean in 17th. Soya being 6th century. So last time they asked about tapioca. So next we have to prepare for all the crops when they were introduced. So next time question may be on any other crop. So botanical origin, what is geographical origin? Geographical origin is a place where the particular crop was originated and the place where we can form most diversity of a particular crop. That is the geographical origin. When it comes to the botanical origin, the cultivated species are domesticated from the wild species. So the cultivate from which wild species the cultivated species was domesticated, that we can, that species we consider as a progenitor species. That means tomato was domesticated from the Solanum serrasiformes. Now the interesting thing in the tomato domestication was fruit size. Actually in all the wild species of tomato the fruit size was big, but in cultivated tomato the fruit size, in all the wild tomatoes the fruit size was small, in cultivated types the fruit size was big. That means tomato was domesticated for larger fruit size. So tomato was originated from the Solanum serrasiformes, and brinjal from Solanum incanum, chili from Capsicum annuum variety minimum, and Capsicum chinensis from Capsicum fugescens, and potato from Solanum stenotomum, okra from Abelmaspis tuberculatus. Actually potato and okra both are polyploids. They have been originated by natural hybridization followed by the doubling of chromosomes. That means potato Solanum stenotomum is diploid. it has been crossed, naturally it was crossed by some other species, and the following F1 was, the following F1 had the doubling of chromosomes. This everything happened naturally, no artificial thing. So the cultivated Solanum tuberosum was originated by the hybridization between diploid Solanum stenotonum and some other unknown species, followed by the doubling of chromosomes. Likewise, Wokra. Wokra is polyploid and the chromosome number is phenotypical 130. So, Ebimascus tuberculatus chromosome number is, I think, n is equal to 36. So, this Ebimascus tuberculatus was hybridized with another unknown species, and the F1 had the doubling of chromosomes, so that the polyploid Wokra Ebimascus esculentus originated. So, likewise, P originated from Physum elateus, French bean from Caseolus aeborigines, cowpea from Vigna decangitiana variety mensensi, cluster bean from Cyamopsis senegalensis. So, there will be a question every time, even in the NET and the ARS Glimpse examination also, regarding this progenitor species of the cultivated types. So, cucumber from Hardwicki, watermelon from Citrullus colocynthis, betel gourd from variety abbreviata, midge gourd from Ulfa graveolens, snake gourd from Trichogenes cookmayerna, and bottle gourd from Lagenaria sperica. So botany and breeding. So for before going for any breeding method, we have to know the botany of the crop, especially its reproductive biology. What is the mode of pollination in a particular crop? We should know, so that the breeding selection of breeding method depends upon the reproductive biology of a crop. So if we see this tomato, pea, French bean, cluster bean, lambda beans, almost all legumes are hermaphrodite, and they have self-pollination mechanism. So what are the different self-pollination mechanisms? Pea, cleistogamy. What is cleistogamy? Flower never opens. So the flower of the pea never opens. So obviously there will be a self-pollination. Pea is the highly self-pollinated crop among the vegetables. This was also a previous question. It was asked, I think, in the ARS Glimpse when I was writing. So pea had the mechanism of cleistogamy. So it exhibits self-pollination because in cleistogamy, flower never opens. And tomato. Tomato has chiasmogamy. Chiasmogamy means flower opens after pollination. So obviously there will be self-pollination. So tomato and pea. Pea is the highly self-pollinated crop, followed by the tomato and other leguminous vegetables like French bean, cluster bean, lambda beans, cowpea, all are self-pollinated crops. Often cross-pollinated. What are the often cross-pollinated? They are generally self-pollinated as a rule, but up to some extent, cross-pollination will be there. So brinjal, chili, okra, and lima bean are often cross-pollinated vegetables. So cross-pollinated, almost all the cucurbits are cross-pollinated, because if you see their sex forms, they are monoecious, gynoecious, andromonoecious, dioecious. That means they are not hermaphrodite flowers. Male and female flowers are different in cucurbits. So they have different types of sex forms. Cucumber has monoecious and gynoecious. We will see what is the advantage of a gynoecious form in the coming slides. Andromonoecious. Andromonoecious means male plus hermaphrodite. Monoecious, male and female on same plant. Gynoecious, only female flowers. Gynoecious means only female flowers. Monoecious means male and female flowers are separate, but they present on the same plant. Dioecious means male and female plants are separate. Enter here, the difference between monoecious and dioecious is, in monoecious, male and female flowers present on the same plant, but in dioecious, both the plants are different. So almost all cucurbits are propagated through seed, except spine gourd, sweet gourd, pointed gourd, and ivy gourd. All these four gourds are propagated through vegetative means. And moreover, ivy gourd has vegetative carpi. And generally it is said that generally cross-pollinated vegetables have a certain degree of inbreeding depression. Inbreeding depression means when you self-pollinate a cross-pollinated crop, there is a reduction in the vigor and the fertility. So we call it as an inbreeding depression. But in case of cucurbits, there is no inbreeding depression. This is a very rare exemption among the all cross-pollinated crops, including field crops, bajra, whatever the other cross-pollinated crops. Among all the crops, cucurbits, though they are cross-pollinated, they do not have increasing depression. The reason behind this was cucurbits in the earlier generations are hermaphrodite forms, self-pollinated forms. In evolution, from hermaphrodite, they have become into andromonaceous, monoecious, and dioecious. So it's, in the beginning, they were hermaphrodite and self-pollinated forms, so they do not have the inbreeding depression. Putlines are also possible. And there is only one bean. This is the runner bean. Almost all leguminous are self-pollinated except this runner bean, Phaseolus coccineus. Though it is having the hermaphrodite flowers, it is a cross-pollinated crop due to the presence of the gametophytic self-incompatibility. I think you all must be knowing what is mate stability, what is self-incompatibility. Your teachers might have taught you in the classes, so I will not be going deep into the explaining the terms. If anybody is having doubt, you can ask me, then we will see. So male sterility, what is male? I will tell in very briefly what is male sterility. Male sterility means absence of the functional pollen grains. Pollen grains are non-functional. Sometimes the anthers may not dehiscence also. So that is called male sterility. Presence of the non-functional pollen grains, that means sterile pollen grains, are non-dehiscence of the anthers. In tomato, we have one accepted stigma character in Solanum hirsutum species. In Solanum hirsutum, the stigma is accepted, means the stigma is lengthier than the anther cone. So the stigma protrudes out from the anther cone. So due to the longitudinal anther dehiscence, the anthers cannot reach the top portion of the stigma. The anthers of the pollen of the same flower cannot reach the stigma of the same flower, because the stigma is lengthier than the anthers. So this character we can utilize in hybrid seed production. But in vegetables commercially, in two crops only male sterility was exploited. They are chili and muskmelon. That we will explain later. How do we maintain these male sterile plants? These male sterile plants, these genetic male sterile plants, are in general homozygous recessive nature. So they have to be crossed with the heterozygous male fertile MSMS, and so that the population will be MSMS and MSMS. So we have to cross a male sterile plant with a heterozygous male fertile plant for its maintenance. Yeah, the resulting population we have both male fertile plants and more sterile plants. So how we identify the male sterile plants from a mixed population? So we should have a morphological marker to identify the male sterile plants. So when we talk about the watermelon, we will discuss this one. So now we will grow crop by crop briefly. So tomato, you all know that tomato botanical name was Solanum lycopersicum, and there are two sections. One is zulycopersicum, belongs to the red fruit types, and the iriopersicum belongs to the green fruit types. And if you see the tomato fruit, the sugar content is more in the pericarp than the locules, and the acid content is more in the locules than the pericarp. You might be knowing what is locule and what is pericarp, you all know. So there are shelf life increasing genes. Shelf life increasing is a very big concern in tomato, not only in tomato, all the vegetables, because all fruits and vegetables are perishable. We cannot store them longer time. So we have to send them to market immediately as soon as we harvest. This is a very big problem in case of the fruits and vegetables. So they have identified some genes which can increase the shelf life. There are three genes. Two are single recessive genes and one is a single dominant gene, RIM and NOR. RIM and NOR. RIM means ripening inhibitor gene. NOR means non-ripening. NR means never ripe. NR, never ripe, is a single dominant gene, whereas RIM and NOR are the single recessive genes. And there is another gene, AFT, anthocyanin fruit. You might have seen black tomatoes, may not be in India, photos in Google or somewhere, sometimes in Facebook also people share. So these black tomatoes, the black color is due to the presence of high amount of anthocyanins, and the anthocyanins is governed by a single dominant gene, AFT, anthocyanin fruit. And this question was asked maybe 2 years ago in a NET examination or ARS examination, what is the gene of anthocyanin content in tomato. So single and double seed method is followed in tomato. In almost all self-fecundated crops, we follow this method. And double back cross was done in tomato. You all may be knowing the back cross. Back cross means the F1 progeny we cross back to the current parent consecutively for 5 to 6 years to recover the genome of the entire genome of the recurrent parent. That is back cross, right? So if anybody, maybe they might have taught you in plant breeding course all the things. So you can go to plant breeding, you can open the plant breeding book and you can read once again to refresh the concepts. So double back cross. Double back cross means here F1 was back cross to both the parents. Normally back cross, what happens? We back cross the F1 to the recurrent parent only. But in double back cross method, we back cross the F1 to both the parents. After 3-4 generations of back crossing, the two back crossing populations we will hybridize. So this was done in tomato to combine the large fruit size and earliness. The variety Punjab Tropic had the large fruit size, but it was a late variety. The variety HS101 was having small fruit, but it is an early variety. So we have to combine the earliness and large fruit size. So to combine earliness and large fruit size, double back cross method was adopted in tomato. In tomato, hybrids are more popular than the OPV because by virtue hybrids are high yielding, more and more profitable. So first hybrid in India was Karnataka. It was developed by the Indo-American Hybrid Seeds Bangalore. And here is the important variety Hisar Anmol. It was crossed with Hisar Alung and Solanum Hirsutum Fame Glabratum. This is a leaf color resistant violet, resistant variety. This is the first variety developed against leaf curl disease. And here the species used as a source of resistance is Solanum Hirsutum Fame Glabratum. This is the most frequently asked question. Almost every year this question will come. Solanum Hirsutum Fame Glabratum. So there are some varieties. One more thing I want to tell you, when it comes to horticulture, fruits and vegetables, generally people are afraid of varieties. There are a huge number of varieties in each crop. How do we remember all these varieties? So as per my experience, I'm telling you, no need to worry about the varieties, better concentrate on the concepts. There may be 3-4 questions on varieties only, not more than that. That too, they will be popular varieties or recently released varieties. So don't worry about the by hearting the names of all the varieties, and don't waste time on the varieties. So remember only few important varieties from each crop. So Arka Rakshak, Arka Samrat, and Arka Vikas. Arka Rakshak and Samrat are the triple disease resistant hybrids, and Arka Vikas is a drought tolerant one. So mutants S1243, PKM1, and Pusa Lal Mirthi were developed through gamma irradiation. And Pusa Lal Mirthi, it is having a thick pericarp suitable for the long distance transport. And remember the parents of the important crosses. They may ask sometimes the hybrid was originated from the cross between which are the parents like that. But don't give much stress on remembering all the names of all the varieties. So next is Brinjal. It's called Aubergine in French. And there are three varieties in Brinjal: round or egg shape or variety Esculentum, long and slender or variety Serpentinum, and dwarf one is variety Depression. So the Brinjal has linoleic and linolenic acids. They are the polyunsaturated fatty acids. So consumption of the Brinjal reduces the blood cholesterol level. And Brinjal is an often cross-pollinated crop due to heterostyly. You all know that there are 4 types of flowers in Brinjal. Long style flowers, medium style, pseudo short style, and short style. In case of long style, the style is lengthier than the anthers, and in case of medium style, both the anthers and the length of the stigma are same. Pseudo short and short, where the style length is less than the anthers length, but they are sterile. So fruit set generally happens in 2 types of flowers only. One is long style, another one is medium style. So there is an anti-nutrient factor, solanum. Anti-nutrient factor means some of their toxic chemicals. So solanin is an anti-nutrient factor present in Brinjal, and greater than 20 milligrams per 100 grams of the edible portion, it becomes toxic. So for edible purpose, the Brinjal fruit should have less than 20 milligrams solanin content. And you all know that upon cutting the Brinjal fruit, even apple also, if you cut the fruit, immediately it turns into brown color. That is due to the action of the enzyme polyphenol oxidase. This is also common question. Polyphenol oxidase enzyme is responsible for the discoloration of the brinjal fruits upon cutting. The same for apple also. And white brinjal is good for diabetic patients. There are three colors of fruits generally we see in case of brinjal: purple, green, and white. And the purple color is dominant over green, and green is dominant over white. All three colors are found by single gene, but the dominance order is purple is dominant than green, and green is dominant than white. Popular varieties are Pusa Purple Long, Pusa Purple Flushed Out, Pusa Purple Round, and fruit borer Lucinodes Organolis is a greater menace in brinjal. So bacterial weevil can form up like other major diseases. Pusa Bairo, Pusa Anupam are resistant to form up with blight, and these are the varieties resistant to bacterial weevil. And here in brinjal, Bagcross was successfully utilized for transferring the bacterial weevil resistant gene because it is a single dominant gene. It was successfully transferred to the cultivated types through back crossing. And there was a debate previously about the BT brinjal also. BT brinjal against the fruit borer Lucinodes organolis was developed by the Monsanto. It has the gene Cry1AC. 4 years ago, it was allowed for commercial cultivation in Bangladesh. In Bangladesh, BT brinjal has been growing commercially. So far, no any adverse effects were reported. In India, it was not allowed. Excuse me. Chili, there are 5 domesticated species in chili: Capsicum annuum, hot pepper, Bordeaux pepper, Tabasco, Capsicum fruticans, and Capsicum chinensis. This Capsicum chinensis is common in Kerala, and the specialty of Capsicum chinensis is it is having upright fruits. The fruits are not drooping types, the fruits are upright and grow towards the sky. So a single recessive gene governs this character, upright fruits. And Capsicum buccatum is resistant to powdery mildew and anthracnose. And Capsicum pubescens has the most pungent fruits. So highly pungent fruits, Tejpur cultivars, they may be growing in Assam, taking these Tejpur cultivars. They belong to the family, the botanical name is Capsicum pubescens variety, the Haru. And there are questions about the flower color of the capsicum, because in all the 5 cultivated species of capsicum, flower and anther colors are different. In Capsicum annuum and Capsicum fruticans, the corolla is white and the anthers are blue. In Capsicum buccatum, it is a white color corolla with yellow spots and yellow color anthers. In pubescens, eczema and cardiency has purple color corolla and purple anthers. But these are the most common questions regarding the flower morphology, because all these 5 species, they have different types of flower color and anther colors. And chili is rich in vitamin A, C, E, and P. And oleoresin, the oleoresin capsicum, which is responsible for the pungency of the chili, is governed by a single dominant gene. And the placenta means in seed it will be there. So the placenta has more pungent, followed by the seeds and pericarp. The sticky gummy substance on the seed, if you open the fresh chili fruit, there is, above the seeds, there is some sticky gummy substance, that is placenta. Placenta has more pungency followed by the seeds and pericarp. So Arka Abir is a variety that is used for the color extraction because of the dark red color, the anthocyanins can be extracted from the chili. So there are some important varieties that are resistant to various diseases, like Arka Lohit and Arka Sufal, resistant to powdery mildew. And these are the CH1 and CH3. CH1 and CH3 are the 2 hybrids, chili hybrid 1 and chili hybrid 3, are developed by using the male sterile female parents by Punjab Agriculture University. Here, first time in India, male hybrids based on the male sterility were developed by PAU. And CH1 was a cross between male sterile line 12 and Louisiana lungs. Actually, what was the advantage of male sterile line? Because the parent is a male sterile, there is no need of emasculation. Generally, what we do in case of female parent, we have to remove the anthers, emasculation, to prevent the self-pollination in a female parent. But what happens in a male sterile plant? Since the plants are males carry, they do not have any functional pollen. So there is no need of emasculation. It reduces the cost and labor. So CH1 and CH3 are the two chili hybrids were developed based on the males, by using the male sterile female parents. And you should know the process. These processes are often asked, what are the parents, what are the parents of CH1 and CH3. And there are three male sterile hybrids developed by IIHR, Arka Meghana, Arka Sweta, and Arka Harita. And there was one hybrid developed by IIBR Varanasi, that is Kasi Sur, that was also based on the male sterility, and the male sterile line was CCA4261 into Usa Jwala. So there are some other varieties here resistant to various diseases and insect pests. You can go through them. And there are Arka Mohini, Arka Gaurav, Arka Basant, and Pusa Deepi. They are the F1 hybrids of the bell pepper and the capsicum, which is generally grown in the poly house. MDU1 is a mutant variety. And Haihua 3 is a capsicum fruticans variety developed through anther culture in China. You know anther culture? We culture the anthers so that the haploid plants will come. We have to double the chromosome number of those haploid plants by giving the calcium treatment so that the diploid will form. So by that way, they developed one variety in China that is called Haihua 3. The short days increase the productivity of chili. Short days are required for increasing the productivity of chili. So another crop is okra. So it is called gumbo in North America. Okra was originated in, actually there was a contradiction regarding the origin of the okra. And generally three places they say. One is Ethiopia, another one is India, another one is West Africa, especially Ghana, the origin of the okra. Okra is a polyploid species. Abelmascus tuberculatus, N=29, and another unknown species, N=36, natural hybridization was occurred, and followed by the F1 had the natural doubling of the chromosomes. So thus the cultivated Abelmascus esculentus was originated with the 2N=130. And there are three cultivated species in okra: Abelmascus esculentus, Mannyhart, and Mostatus. Abelmascus Mannyhart was also used as a leafy vegetable in Africa, and it is resistant to yellowing mosaic virus. And there are four resistant species identified against the yellowing mosaic virus. We all know that yellowing mosaic virus is a major disease in okra. So this Mannyhart subspecies, Mannyhart and Tetrophilus, all these three species can be hybridized with the cultivated Abelmascus esculentus. But the problem is all these three species do not have the true resistance. They have false resistance only. That means they have the infection of the virus, but they do not exhibit any symptoms. That means they are the symptomless species. So when we hybridize, when we transfer the resistance from this Mannyhart subspecies, Mannyhart and Tetrophilus to the cultivated types, the resultant progeny is generally resistant for few years only, 3 years or 4 years. Afterwards, eventually they are breaking the resistance because of the false resistance in the source. That's why Kosa Savani or Arka Namika, Arka Bhai, Punjab Padmini, Parbani Kranti, lot of YVMV resistant varieties were developed by using these three species as a source of resistance, but eventually they lost the resistance due to lack of true resistance in the source. At the same time, developing of the new variants in the virus also. But there is one species, Abelmascus pungens, which is having the true resistance to the virus, but it is not possible with the cultivated Abelmascus esculentus. That is the problem. There is a hybridization barrier between these two species. And Abelmascus angulosus is resistant to frost and low temperature. This is also one of the most commonly asked questions, Abelmascus angulosus. And there are some other species like Ficalnius, Cnetus, and Calais. And Abelmascus esculentus okra is rich in iodine content. It is used against the. So YVMV is an important disease, as we talked earlier, and it is transmitted by the white fly. The resistance is bound by the two complementary dominant genes, and okra is an often cross-pollinated crop. And for export quality okra, the fruit length should be 6 to 9 cm length. This is also a previous question. So the export quality okra should have a fruit length of 6 to 9 cm length. So back cross and pedigree breeding method was the adopted breeding method for the YVMV resistance breeding in okra. So Parbani Kranti was developed. Back cross pedigree means the F1 was hybridized to the recurrent parent for 3 to 4 generations. After 4 generations of back crossing, pedigree method is followed. I think you know how the pedigree method goes. So just go to textbooks and just read what is pedigree, what is back cross. So the back cross pedigree method was followed in okra for transferring the YVMV resistance in Parbani Kranti, in Punjab Padmini, P7, Arkanomica, Arkabhai. MDU1 is a gamma irradiated mutant of Pusa Savani developed by Tamil Nadu Agriculture University. And Punjab 8 or EMS 8 is an EMS induced mutant. EMS means it is a chemical mutagenic agent, ethyl methane sulfonate. It was developed by Punjab Agriculture University, and there were some important varieties released by IAVR also. Just go to the website and see. And there were some good hybrids that were developed by the private companies which were popular. Excuse me. They are Varsha and Vijay from by Indo-American Hybrid Seeds, Organic and Panchali by Century Seeds. Based on the processing purpose, there are some suitable varieties for canning, Pusa Savani, Janardhan, and for dehydration, Pusa Savani selection 2, for freezing selection 2. And Perkins Green Long is an introduced variety. It is an exotic variety. So with this one, we completed the solanaceous crops and okra. Now we discuss about the leguminous crops. Excuse me. Pea, Pisum sativum. It's a winter vegetable and generally grown during winter time in North Indian plains. And there are two types of peas. One is field pea, Pisum sativum variety arvens, and garden pea, Pisum sativum variety sativum. These both the species have different flower colors. Field pea is having the colored flowers, whereas garden pea is having the white flowers. The white flower ones are the garden pea, and the colored flower ones are the field pea. And there are some other species like sweet pea, Pisum saccharatum, and snap pea, Pisum macrocarpum. And as I told earlier, pea is a highly self-pollinated crop. It exhibits cleistogamy, and the origin of the pea is Ethiopia. And there are two types of peas, leafless pea and the tendrilless pea. Leafless pea. In leafless pea, the leaflets are converted into tendrils. So the entire plant is having only tendrils, no leaves and leaflets. It is governed by a single recessive gene, AF. And this leafless pea is said to be tolerant to waterlogging. So this extra leaflet pea or tendrilless pea. So what happens in extra leaflet pea? The tendrils are converted into leaflets. There are no tendrils in extra leaflet pea, and in leafless pea there are no leaves. So both are governed by single recessive genes, AF leafless pea and extra leaflet pea PL. And powdery mildew resistance in pea is a single recessive gene. This is the most common question. Every time this question appears, previously it used to appear every time this question. Powdery mildew resistance in pea is governed by a single recessive gene, whereas downy mildew and fusarium wheat resistance are governed by single dominant gene. So you people can prepare notes like powdery mildew, single recessive gene in how many crops, what are the crops, and single dominant gene in how many crops. So that for these important characters, you can prepare a notes about the recessive gene or dominant gene or how many genes for each crop, so that you can easily read. If you read crop wise, no, these genes, you will forget. You may not remember every time. So when you read that crop, you remember, but when you go to the next crop, you will forget. So for all the crops, you make a table, important characters and what is the gene action. So there are three types of varieties in pea: early varieties, mid varieties, and late varieties. Just go to any textbook and see what are the early varieties. Important ones only, no need to buy out all the variety names. So Arkil is the early variety of pea, and Palam Priya is a recently, really not recently means 6-7 years ago. Palampriya, it is resistant to powdery mildew. So Pusa Bipasha is tolerant to Fusarium wilt, and there are some varieties by AHR also, Karthik, Ajit, Priya, Pramod, and Apurva. And Arka Ajit was developed through backcrossing to a recurrent parent, Bonvillei. Bonvillei is an introduced variety from USA, I think, USA, from Germany. But Arka Ajit was developed through backcrossing method. And there is another variety, Arka Sampurna, resistant to powdery mildew, and Rust, it is snappy variety, that means Pisum Macrocarpa, Arka Sampurna. So hybrid development in PE is not economical, high cost. Because of the cleistogamy, that means the flower never opens, and the small size flower, emasculation is very difficult. It is not cost effective, very laborious. So hybrid development is not at all economical in pea. So almost all the pea varieties are pea-lines. So leafless pea is tolerant to water logging, as I told earlier. And one variety of leafless pea is Aparna. And there are two seed types, wrinkle seed and the smooth seed. Wrinkle seed is having protein content 26 to 33%, whereas smooth seed is having protein content 23 to 31%. So there are varieties suitable for various processing purposes, for dehydration, for freezing, and the maturity of pea is measured by the tendrometer. Only pea, any other crop also, we can measure the maturity by using the tendrometer. And shelling percentage is 40 to 45%. What is shelling percentage? Shelling percentage means after removing the seed from the husk, so that from the from 100 kg pods, you can get 40 to 45 kg seeds. The remaining is a husk. So French and other beans. So you know the dry seeds of French are called as rajma, a popular vegetable in North India. Rajma, it's a shallow rooted crop, cool season crop, but susceptible to frost. And there are four species of French bean and allied beans, French and allied beans. Phaseolus vulgaris is a French bean, Phaseolus ulmatus, lima bean, Phaseolus acutifolius, tapari bean, and Phaseolus coccineus, normal bean. All the four species are hermaphrodite, but only three are self-pollinated. Vulgaris, ulmatus, and acutifolius are self-pollinated, whereas coccineus, the runner bean, all three are self-pollinated, and the runner bean coccineus is the cross-pollinated type. So Phaseolus coccineus is a long day plant also. All are day neutral, and coccineus runner bean is a long day plant and cross-pollinated crop due to gametophytic self-incompatibility, and it is resistant to viruses and weeds. And the acutifolius tapari bean is tolerant to high temperatures, 35 degrees centigrade and drought. And the filiformis is tolerant to cold and salinity. And this is, there are two processing methods in the French bean. One is canning and the other one is freezing. For canning, we use the white color seeds. For freezing, we use the whole pods. So this was also a previous question. Seeds, white color seeds were used for canning, and whereas the whole pods are used for freezing. So just remember, canning seeds, for freezing, whole pods. Here the powdery mildew is single dominant gene. In the case of pea, the powdery mildew resistance is single recessive gene. Here it is single dominant gene. And Pusa Parvati is a mutant variety. Generally, crop mutations are done by the either gamma rays, physical means, or EMS, chemical means. But here it is an X-ray induced mutant, Pusa Parvati, and resistant to powdery mildew. So there are some other important varieties resistant to various types. So there is Kodaikanal, it is Phaseolus lunatus variety, Kodaikanal 1, lima bean or butter bean variety, Kodaikanal 1. So this is French and allied beans. So next is cowpea. Cowpea is also having three species. One is Vigna unguiculata, subspecies unguiculata, that is the common cowpea. And Vigna unguiculata, subspecies biflora, it's called Kachang bean. And subspecies SP pedalis, it is yardlong bean. So cowpea is a warm season drought tolerant crop, and cowpea is also used as a cover crop and a green manure crop. And cowpea is photosensitive, so it will not produce spots throughout the year. It is sensitive to photo period. It's pretty high protein content in the dry seeds. It's called as vegetable meat. So what is the difference between these three species, subspecies sanguiculata and subspecies biflora and subspecies cespedalis, the pod size? In case of sanguiculata, the pod size is 20 to 30 centimeters. In case of biflora, the pod size is very less, 7 to 13 centimeters. Yard long beans are the long pods. The pod length is 30 to 90 centimeters. That means 1 to 3 feet. The pod length is the major difference among these three subspecies. And the Kajan bean is also resistant to pod borer and pulse beetle. Pusa falconi for summer season, Pusa barsati and Arka garma for rainy season. And there are some photo insensitive varieties. Nowadays, photo insensitive varieties are developed, so they can be grown in both summer and the rainy season. They are Fusa do fasali. I think in Hindi, you know the meaning of do fasali. Do means two, fasali means crops. So Pusa do fasali, Arka suman, and Arka samruddhi, which are the photo insensitive varieties. They can be grown in both summer and rainy seasons. And Pusa komal is resistant to bacteria blight. Arka mangal is a yard long bean variety. The pod length is 30 to 90 centimeters. And four male sterile genes are also identified in poppy, but not commercially utilized so far. And Dolichos bean or Lab Lab bean. Earlier it was, the genus name was Dolichos, but now the genus name was Lab Lab. So it was originated in India. So it is known as Indian bean or Hyacinth bean. It is cool season drought tolerant crop. Whereas cowpea is a warm season drought tolerant crop, and the Lab Lab bean is a cool season drought tolerant crop. It is also two types, field bean and garden bean. Field bean is Labla purpureus variety lignosus. It is used as a pulse, and the pods have more fiber content. Whereas the garden bean is variety typicus. It is used as a vegetable, and the pod walls have less fiber content. And this difference was asked for a 2-mark question in my ERS mains examination. So it may come as objective also. So the field bean is having the high fiber content in the pods, and it is used as pulse. And the garden bean is having the less fiber content in the pods. It is used as a vegetable. So that is the major difference. And there are different varieties, photo insensitive varieties, Jai, Vijay, Amog, Soumya, Sampram, Swagat. That means they can be grown in both the seasons. So next one is cluster bean. Cluster bean is an amide producing vegetable, and cluster bean is the commercial crop among all the leguminous vegetables, because it is having a gourd gum, and gourd gum is an export oriented commodity. So cluster bean is the most commercial crop among all the leguminous vegetables, and it produces amides like glutamine and aspergine, so it is called an amide producing vegetable also. And it is also warm season drought tolerant crop, and it is tolerant to high temperature also. It is also used as forage and green manure crop, and the endosperm of the seeds have galactomannan. It is commonly called as gourd gum. This is having industrial uses, and this is a export quality commodity. So this cluster bean is an industrial crop. The seeds, the endosperm is having 60 to 80% galactomannan. And it is self-pollinated crop and the shorter plant. French bean is day neutral. Pea is day neutral. The cluster bean, this is shorter plant. And runner bean, Phaseolus coccineus, is a long day plant. So you write all these things in one page. You make your own notes so that it is easy to remember. So giant type varieties have the high galactomannan content. And Pusa mousmi is a rainy season type, whereas Sala Bahar and Nava Bahar are the photo insensitive types. They can be grown in both summer and the rainy season. Pusa Navabahar is an important cross. Pusa Navabahar is a cross between Pusa Mousami and Pusa Sadabahar. And the young parts of cluster bean are having the anti-nutrient factor hydrogen cyanide, which is toxic to the plants when the animals eat the cluster bean plants. No, it becomes toxic to them because of the presence of the CAC. So broad bean, it is also known as a faba bean or horse bean. It was originated in the East and Western Mediterranean regions. The plants have square and erect stems. The stem is square, not round. Square-shaped stems are present in broad bean. And the pods also upright, clusters of 5 or more. They are not pendant type pods. The pods are upright. They grow towards the sky. So there are three varieties actually. This is a faba variety major. It was having the large seeds. Faba variety minor and faba equina are having the small seeds. And the pollen of the broad bean cause allergy to humans. And there are some alkaloids or tannins present in the broad bean seeds. There are visin and convisin. So the consumption of excess consumption of broad bean seeds may cause a disease called phlegm. Phlegm means it is hemolytic anemia in children. Excuse me. There are two varieties, Pusa sumit and Pusa udit. So bing bean, we have a minor beans, godsend vegetable and vegetable of 20th century. Very long time, maybe in 2009, I think, in JRF examination, they asked this question, what is the godsend vegetable? Then our seniors, my seniors were writing the JRF examination, it was asked in 2009, which one is the godsend vegetable? So guava bean, manila bean, four angle bean, other common names, origin was in Africa, Madagascar. You all know you can easily identify the Madagascar. It was a little separated portion from the Africa towards in the east side. So bung bean is free from all major pest and diseases. It's a short day plant. Swart bean, Cannavale's gladiator. You all know the movie Gladiator. So you remember the swart. So Cannavale's gladiator. And Cannavale's virosa, it is grown in Northeast India, especially in Manipur and Mizoram, Cannavale's virosa. The seeds of the swart bean contain hessian and saponins. It is a perennial climber tolerant to drought. Soya bean, glycine max, it was introduced to India in 6th century. And you all know the soya bean. The fermented products of soya bean are known as tofu and natto. And there is a fermented paste from soya bean known as miso. And the vegetable soya bean is known as edamame. So I listed some anti-nutrient factors present in the peas and beans here. Cowpea is having alpha amylase inhibitor. Garlicas bean is having trypsin inhibitor. Trypsin inhibitor means trypsin is a enzyme produces in our stomach. And this trypsin digests the proteins. It breaks the protein into the amino acids in our stomach, so that the amino acids are absorbed into our body. So this trypsin inhibitor, it inhibits the enzyme trypsin so that the proteins are not divided into amino acids in our stomach, so that the amino acids will not be available for our body. So soya bean, swart bean, jock bean have saponins, swart bean, cluster bean have HCM, broad bean is having tannins like visin and convisin, pea is having phytic acid. This phytic acid, it reacts with the ions, so calcium, magnesium ions in our food, and it forms salts so that the calcium and magnesium will not be available for our body. It happens in our stomach. So now we come to the cucumber. The largest vegetables family is Cucurbitaceae, and cucumber is the most common vegetable in Cucurbitaceae. So the second most widely cultivated cucurbit after watermelon, it is indigenous to India, and 12 o'clock. I will finish within 30-40 minutes. So it is a salad crop. It is not a cooked one. Salad crop means we eat the raw cucumber. And there is one species, Cucumis hybridus. It was a cross between two Cucumis hystrix and the Cucumis sativus. Powdery mildew and downy mildew resistance in cucumber was done by a single recessive gene, and gynoecious lines are present in cucumber. So what is the advantage of this gynoecious lines? Gynoecious lines have all female flowers. There is no male flower, so that there is no need of emasculation or removal of male flower when we go for the hybridization. So it reduces the cost of labor and makes the hybrid seed production economical. Similar to male sterility, the function non-functional pollen grains, so that there is no need of emasculation. Here also no need of, because of monoecious types, we have to remove the male flowers because male and female flowers are present on the same plant. So when you use a gynoecious line as a female parent, there is no need of removal of male flowers, and it facilitates the easy hybridization. So when this gynoecism is coupled with the parthenocarpy, what is the advantage? There is no need of male parents also. So we can get the gynoecism, if it is vegetative parthenocarpy, the flower, the ovary turns into the fruit without pollination. So gynoecium plus parthenocarpy is an added advantage in cucumber. So there are some male sterile genes also there, but the gynoecious lines are more popular in cucumber than the male sterility. So the progenitor was Cucumis hardwicki. And slicing cucumber is having white spine color. Slicing means for raw consumption as a salad. You slice the cucumber fruit and eat it. slicing cucumber is having white spine color. White spine color means if you cut the fruit, you can see the internal portion is white. 20 to 25 centimeter length. There is a pickling cucumber is having less length, 10 to 12 centimeter. There is a slicing cucumber is having more length, 20 to 25 centimeter. Pickling cucumber is used for the making the pickles. So Pusa saniol is a hybrid. It was developed by using the gynoecious lines, a Japanese gynoecious line into the male parent green long napkins. So Pusa saniol is a hybrid developed by using a gynoecious line. This is the important cross. You remember the cross, Japanese gynoecious line into green long napkins. And Pusa barca is a recently released variety. It is an extra RNA type. It is tolerant to high temperature. So you can see in Vishnu Swarup book, you know that vegetable crops in India, the book was written by Vishnu Swarup. In that book, you can see table there, they have given the characters of some important varieties. So muskmelon, actually the genus Cucumis is having two types, melotypes. Melotypes belong to melons and the Cucumis type belongs to cucumber. So melo group, it was also originated in Africa. Cucumis melo variety Cantalupensis, it is called the common muskmelon or cantaloupe. Whereas variety Enodorus is known as winter melon, and the variety Flexuosus or Utilissimus is known as snake melon or long melon. And the variety Konoman is known as oriental pickling melon, and the variety Dudai is known as mango melon, and variety Momodica snap melon, this is important, variety Momodica snap melon, this is also commonly grown in India. The fruit cracks when it is ready for harvesting. When the fruit is ripened, the fruit cracks. So it's called snap melon or fruit in Hindi. Momodica, sorry, Cucumis melo variety Momodica is a snap melon. Just remember it. Among all the melons, no, muskmelon has a necked skin. You can see the neck-like structure on the skin of the fruit. That is a muskmelon, and it is having the aromatic flavor. And there are different types of sex forms. Long melon and snap melon are monoecious, and remaining all are andromonoecious. All these muskmelon, long melon, and snap melons are intercrossable, and they can produce fertile hybrids. Snap melon is resistant to downy mildew, watermelon mosaic virus, zucchini yellow mosaic virus, and cucumber green bottle mosaic virus and aphids. Variety callosus is resistant to fruit fly. Fruit fly is an important insect pest of these melons. Powdery mildew and fusarium wilt resistance gone by single dominant gene, and the fruit fly resistance by single recessive gene. And there is another species, Cucumis angvira, commonly known as Gedkins. This is pickling type. It is having fruit length is only 4 to 5 centimeters. Similar, it looks like cucumber, but the length is very less, 4 to 5 centimeters. Gherkins are exported from India to USA and other countries. So the Gherkins botanical name, Cucumis angvira, you remember, this is also important one. So all the desert types are andromonoecious and non-desert types are the monoecious. Here in muskmelon also functional maturity was observed, 5 recessive maturity genes. Like chili, also in muskmelon also, first male sterile based hybrid was developed by the Punjab Agricultural University. So in chili and muskmelon, where the male sterility is commercially exploited. So the Punjab hybrid one, or the MH1, is a cross between male sterile line into Harmadu, and MH10, here they use the gynoecious line into Punjab Sunehari. This WI998 is a gynoecious line from Wisconsin, USA. WI means Wisconsin. So the Punjab hybrid one, or MH1 of the muskmelon, MH1 is muskmelon hybrid, was based on the exploitation of male sterility, and the MH10 was based on the exploitation of gynoecism. So remember the crosses. And Pusa rasraj, here the female parent is monoecious. Monoecious means the plant is having both male and female flowers. Here we have to remove the male flowers before the anthesis. Anthesis means opening of the flower. So M3 monoecious line and Durgapur madhu was utilized for the development of the hybrid Pusa rasraj. And Jobla 96.2 is tolerant to high soil pH. And Arka Sheetal is a long melon variety, and Pusa Shandar is a snap melon variety. So there are only one variety for minor melons, they may ask. So the powdery mildew source was actually identified in India. The powdery mildew resistant source was identified in India, and it was transported to USA, and it was utilized there in development of powdery mildew resistant lines PMR45 and PMR6. And there are some important varieties. Arka Rajahans is resistant to powdery mildew. It is having white color flesh, and Pusa Sunehari, it is having the orange color flesh. And Durgapur Madhu and Punjab Suneri are resistant to Fusarium wilt. In case of melons, either in muskmelon and watermelon, cool nights and warm days are required for the accumulation of sugars. And this is the most common question. Cool nights and warm days are required for the accumulation of sugars in both muskmelon and watermelon. So watermelon was also originated in Africa. It was originated in Kalahari Desert. Watermelon is a rich source of iron, and it is a widely cultivated cucurbit. So the bitterness in watermelon is due to the alkaloid cucurbitacin. Chemically, it is tetracyclic triterpenoid. So the red color in watermelon is due to lycopene and anthocyanins. And there are two types of cucurbitacins. And the Citrullus vulgaris, Citrullus colocynthis, and the Citrullus acrophosus are having the cucurbitacin E, whereas Citrullus nadianus is having the cucurbitacin B and E. So citron is an intermediate species between the wild and the cultivated. The wild types are bitter and the cultivated types are sweet. So the citron preserving melon, it is an intermediate between the bitter wild types and the cultivated sweet forms of the watermelon, and it is resistant to Fusarium wilt. And round melon of Tenda, this is also popular in North India, Prea citrullus fistulosus. And male sterility in the watermelon is glabrous male sterilis, single issue gene. I told you in the very beginning, when you cross a male fertile plant with the heterozygous male sterile plant with the heterozygous male fertile plant for its maintenance, the resulting population will be having both the male sterile and male fertile plants. So we have to identify the male sterile plants at the vegetative phase from the mixed population so that we have a marker. We should have a marker. So this glabrous male sterile is the male sterility is linked with the glabrous leaf character. So wherever the glabrous leaves are present in the population, that plant is a male sterile plant. We can easily identify. Likewise, resistant to anthracnose and other diseases governed by single dominant gene, and resistance to powdery mildew governed by a single recessive gene in watermelon. Citrullus colocynthis, the wild type or the progenitor, it is having the high seed oil content, whereas Lanatus, the cultivated type, is having the thin testa. So hybridization was made to combine these two characters, high oil seed content and thin testa. Testa means seed coat. So the colocynthis is resistant to watermelon mosaic virus and Chikungunya mosaic virus. Arca monic multiple is resistant. And the seedless watermelon, very important. The seedless watermelon was first developed in Japan by the scientist Kihara. In India, the first seedless watermelon, Pusa Bedana, was developed by scientist Seshadri. So this, how we develop the seedless watermelon? Seedless watermelon is a triploid. Because of the triploidy, it is sterile. So how we get a triploid? By crossing a tetraploid and diploid. So the Pusa Bedana was developed by crossing a tetra-2, that is a tetraploid line, 4X line from USA, and Pusa Rasal, a 2X from India. So the resultant is a triploid. And there is another triploid seedless variety was developed by IAHR, that is Arca Madhura. But the problem with the triploids is the germination is not easy in triploids. We cannot sow them directly in the field. First, we have to sow them in the plug trays in the poly house, and after germination only, we have to transplant them to the main field. And the seed set requires pollination stimulation. Since the plants are triploid, they are sterile. So how the pollination will happen? So that in case of when you are growing the triploid seedless watermelon, you have to grow 10% either diploid or tetraploid parents. They produce the pollen. This pollen will stimulate the, when reach the stigma of a triploid flower, it stimulates the fruit development. The stimulation is needed for the fruit development in case of a triploid watermelon. So we have to plant along with the triploid plants 10% of the diploid or tetraploid parents. So how do we identify? Because when you plant the 10% of diploid or tetraploid parents in the field, these tetraploid and diploid plants also produce fruits. So how do you identify which is a triploid fruit and which is a triploid seedless fruit, or which is a normal diploid or tetraploid fruit? So for that one, there is a fruit size differentiation should be there. So based on the fruit size, we have to identify which is a triploid fruit and which is a diploid or tetraploid fruit. Durgapur Kesar is a variety with yellow flesh. The yellow color is due to carotene, whereas the red color in the watermelon fruits is due to lycopene and anthocyanins. And the yellow color is due to carotene. Here also, like muskmelon, cool night and warm days are required for the accumulation of sugars in the fruit. So pumpkin and squashes, this is another important group of cucurbits. They are originated in America. Watermelon, muskmelon are originated in Africa. Pumpkin and squashes were originated in America. Cucurbita pipo is summer squash. Cucurbita moschata is a pumpkin. And the orange colored one, orange color is due to beta carotene. And Cucurbita maxima is a winter squash. And erucery is a edible product prepared from the pumpkin. And in case of pumpkin, the leaves and flowers are also edible. The flowers, mostly the pumpkin flowers, are eaten by the people in South India. Maybe in East India also people, they eat the pumpkin flowers. Like okra and potato, pumpkin also amphidiploid or yellow tetraploid. It was developed by hybridization between two species followed by the doubling of the chromosomes. In summer squash is an ornamental cucurbit. It is a bushy nature and it is also known as ornamental cucurbit. It is self-incompatible cucurbit. Self-incompatibility is present in the summer squash. So if we see the summer squash, Cucurbita pepo and the Cucurbita mixta, they are grown for the immature fruits. And the summer squash fruits are very perishable. We cannot store them more than 2 weeks. In case of winter squash and pumpkin, we harvest them at mature stage. They can be stored well up to two to three months. Summer squash, we harvest immature fruits, whereas in winter squash and pumpkin, we harvest mature fruits. Summer squash cannot store well, and winter squash and pumpkin store well because we are harvesting mature fruits. And peduncle, there is a botanical difference. Peduncle is hard in all except Cucurbita maxima. The Cucurbita maxima is having the soft peduncle and remaining all are having the hard peduncle. And pumpkin cannot tolerate frost, and bitterness is gone by a single dominant gene. So this botanical difference and the harvesting difference are very important. So here also male sterility is reported but not commercially utilized, and the male sterility is characterized by the abortion of pollen or male flowers before anthesis. Before anthesis means opening of the flower. Before opening of the flower, the pollen abort, so the male sterility operates. And powdery mildew fruit fly resistance is governed by a single dominant gene. Sometimes bridge cross, you might have heard what is the bridge cross. Bridge cross means when two species are not having cross compatibility. Two species are not having cross compatibility, but we have to hybridize them because of the importance of the transfer of some important characters. In such case, what we do, we take an intermediate species which is crossable with the both the species. So that is called bridge species. So in case of Cucurbita moschata was used as a bridge species to transfer powdery mildew and CMV resistance to Cucurbita pepo. So Cucurbita pepo and the Cucurbita martinezi are not cross compatible, but we have to transfer the resistance from Cucurbita martinezi to Cucurbita pepo. How do we cross? Both can be crossed with Cucurbita moschata. So we cross the Cucurbita martinezi with Cucurbita moschata first, and the resultant F1 you cross with the Cucurbita pepo. Here the Cucurbita moschata is the bridge species, so this is the bridge cross. Likewise, Cucurbita mendeliana can also be used as a bridge species because it is highly compatible with Cucurbita moschata. So Posa alankar is the F1 hybrid of summer squash, EC207050 into selection 1PI18. This cross was also asked earlier in exams. Posa pasand is a summer squash variety, and Arka Suryamukhi, Cucurbita maxima, winter squash type, it is resistant to fruit fly. Arka Chandan, rich in beta carotene. Some other varieties, Posa biswas and Posa vipas. Buffalo guard, this is Cucurbita foetidissima, it is a xerophytic one. Xerophytic means it is adapted to desert conditions, I mean drought zone conditions. It can grow in with limited water conditions. The xerophytes. So the xerophytes, phytic species, reach Cucurbita foetidissima. So Momotica types. Momotica are better guard. There are three types of Momotica: better guard, sweet guard, and spine guard. Better guard is Momotica chalantia, sweet guard is Momotica cochinchinensis, and spine guard is Momotica dioica. So the bitterness is due to the presence of alkaloids, mumodicin, and sweet gourd, Mumodicus cochinchinensis, commonly known as Casca, is grown in Assam and other northeastern states, whereas the spiny gourd, known as Cacol, is grown in eastern and southern India. Mumodica cymbalaria is a triploid species. Interspecific crosses are not successful. Mumodica bitter gourd is not possible with the sweet gourd and spiny gourd. Bitterness is known by the single dominant gene, and here in Mumodica bitter gourd also gynoecious lines were developed, DBT G1, G8263B and G3GA1, and short days or low temperature increases female flowers in bitter gourd. This is very important. Short days and low temperature increase the female flowers so that the number of fruits will be more. So more yield will be obtained when the crop is grown under short day plus low temperature condition. And Panthcarella 1 is highly resistant to that pumpkin beetle. Posa Aushari is the newly released variety, so Aushari bitter gourd. And this spine gourd and sweet gourd are dioecious. Mumodica is monoecious or andromonoecious, but this spine gourd and sweet gourd are dioecious. Male and female plants are different, and the spine gourd and sweet gourd produce tubers also, and the tubers are edible. So the tuber bearing cucurbits are spine gourd and sweet gourd, and are vegetatively propagated by tubers. Then here also, to induce fruit set, we need 10% male plants in the field. So loofah gourds, ridge gourd and sponge gourd. So ridge gourd and sponge gourd belongs to the genus loofah, and they contain a gelatinous compound called loofin, and they are originated in Mexico and Central America. The sponge gourd, the sponge inside the fruit can be used for the baking purpose, and it is used in the preparation of scrubber, sponge, doormats, commonly known as loofah. So these are the genus name comes from this one, loofah. So all loofah species are monoecious except loofah echinata, which is dioecious. Please remember the dioecious species. And where there is an exception from the general rule, just remember it. All loofah species are monoecious except loofah echinata, dioecious. Ridge gourd is monoecious, and one variety from Bihar, that is Sakutia, that is hermaphrodite. In ridge gourd also some gynoecious strains are developed, but not yet commercially exploited for the development of hybrids. And all loofah species are cross-compatible. Here also bitterness in the dominant gene. Male flowers in loofah are appear in clusters, not solitary. Female flowers appear in solitary mode, and whereas the male flowers appear in clusters. Here the important thing is the anthesis in the ridge gourd in evening. That means the flowers of the ridge gourd open in the evening, and they are pale yellow color flowers, whereas the flowers of the sponge gourd open in the morning, and they have the bright yellow flowers. It's very important, the crops which have anthesis in the evening. The Posa Nutan is a new variety of ridge gourd, and Posa Sneha, heat tolerant sponge gourd variety. So Posa Chikni is previously they used to ask, Posa Chikni is the variety of sponge gourd. Now the new variety is Posa Sneha, and the new variety of ridge gourd is Posa Nutan. And bottle gourd, it is also originated in Africa along with the melons. And in all cucurbits, the bitterness is due to the single dominant gene. And the red pumpkin beetle resistance is done by a single dominant gene. And in bottle gourd, there are two fruit shapes in bottle gourd. One is long, like bottle, and another one is round. The long fruit shape is dominant over the round one. And the metazinia exists in bottle gourd, that means the transfer of bitterness through pollen grains. And in India, first time hybrids were developed by public sector in bottle gourd. There are Posa Meghadoot and Posa Manjari in 1971 by IRI. Among all the vegetables, first time hybrids were developed in bottle gourd. They are Posa Meghadoot and Posa Manjari. And there is a bottle gourd cultivar, Renshi, from Taiwan. It is used as a rootstock for watermelon against fusarium. This I will talk about in the upcoming slides. And the important varieties, the newly released important varieties are Posa Samruddhi and Posa Santushti. There are two products are made from the bottle gourd, Kofha and Tutti Frutti. Bottle gourd is having white color flowers, anthesis in the evening. Ridge gourd anthesis in the evening, and bottle gourd anthesis in the evening. And short days and humid climate promote female flowers. In bitter gourd also, short day and low temperature promotes the female flowers. So pointed guard and snake guard. Snake guard originated in India, and Trichogonus alobeta or Merna are known as the progenitors of the cultivated Trichogonus anguina. And the snake guard also rhanthesis in the evening. And there is an important variety PKM1. It is an induced mutant of snake guard. And pointed guard, it is a Trichogonus dioica. Snake guard is a monoecious one, but this pointed guard is a dioecious one. Male and female plants are separate, and this pointed guard is propagated through vegetative means, the vine cuttings. And this is a protein rich cucurbit. Pointed guard is protein rich cucurbit. It is having only 2% protein. 2% is less than compared to the peas and other proteinaceous crops. But in cucurbits, among the cucurbits, it is having high protein content, that is just 2%. It is propagated by vine cuttings 2000 to 2500 cuttings per hectare, not 25,000, 2500 cuttings per hectare. So the cuttings remain dormant in winter and the sprouts when the summer comes. But to induce fruit set, pollination is needed. So we have to plant 10% male plants in the field. Swarna Rekha and Swarna Alokik are the important varieties of pointed guard. So ash guard, Benzinicaesa, monotypic genus. Monotypic genus means the genus Benzinicaesa is having only one species, that is Benzinicaesa hispida. There are no other species. That type of genus is known as monotypic genus. And you all know the fruit surface of the ash guard fruit is having white color wax. So it is also called wax guard. Among all the cucurbits, ash guard is having the long shelf life. And some popular sweet from ash guard is prepared in North India, that is called petha. And sensitive to photoperiod, like bitter guard, in ash guard also short day plus low temperatures promote female flowers. And Kosa urmi and Kosa shreyali are the new varieties of ash guard. Kosa urmi and Kosa shreyali. The ivy guard originated in India, is a dioecious plant. Vegetative parthenocarpy exists, so there is no need of planting of 10% male plants. Here in case of pointed guard, we need to plant 10% male plants because of fruit set pollination is needed. But due to vegetative parthenocarpy in ivy guard, there is no need of planting the 10% of male plants. And chocho, it is origin to Mexico. This is the most commonly asked question. What is the origin of chocho, that is Mexico? One of the most common questions. So chocho is monoecious and it is a single seeded cucurbit. If you see all the cucurbits, the fruits have more number of seeds. But in case of chocho, only one seed is present and it exhibits viviparity. What is viviparity? Viviparity means seed germinates in the fruit itself. When the fruit ripens, seed germinates in the fruit itself. So it is propagated by the sprouted fruits. So some important points we have to, you prepare a notes like this. Sensitive to photoperiod, pointed guard, bitter guard, ash guard, in case of beans, cowpea, like that. So short days and low temperature promote female flowers, long days plus high temperature promote male flowers, and gynaecious lines are developed in cucumber and bitter guard, perennial plus dioecious, pointed guard, ivy, sweet, spine guards, perennial plus monoecious, chocho, and mellitus genes are identified in tomato, chili, cowpea, muskmelon, watermelon, pumpkin. Okra, pumpkin, and potato, they are the allotetraploids. Tetraploids. Muskmelon tolerant to acidity, watermelon and ash guard are tolerant to salinity. The edible portion, in cucumber and watermelon, the edible portion is placenta. In muskmelon and pumpkin, the edible portion is pericarp plus mesocarp. And rich sponge and ash guard, the edible portion is endocarp. And white color flowers are produced in bottle guard, snake guard, pond guard, bitter guard, cucumber, yellow and rich guard, sponge guard, orange color flowers in pumpkin. Anthesis in the evening in bottle guard, snake guard, and cleistogamy, the self-pollination mechanism, cleistogamy present in pea, and chasmogamy in tomato, helicogamy in lima bean. Helicogamy means both male and female reproductive organs in different directions. If anthers are grown in downward directions, the stigma will grow in upward direction. So that is called helicogamy. And heterostyly is present in brinjal. Don't confuse heterostyly with helicogamy. Heterogamy means male and female reproductive organs in different directions. Heterostyly means there is different lengths of style. And dalcas bean, cluster bean, wing bean are short-day plants. Runner bean, faceless, coccineus is a long-day plant. So you make a notes of notes like this. Write down all similar type of crops, all similar type of characters in one place so that you can easily revise it before the exam. That will be useful for you. Just a few days before the exam, it will be useful for you. So in how many crops the powdery mildew resistance is governed by a single dominant gene, and what are the crops where the powdery mildew resistance is governed by single recessive gene? If you make a notes like this, no, it will be useful for you for easy reference before the examinations. So potato, among all the tuber crops, potato is the temperate one. Remaining other tuber crops are the tropical types. So potato was originated in Peru, Bolivia, and in South America. Potato was introduced to India in 17th century. So the deployed species are Solanum furigena and Solanum stenotonum. We know Solanum stenotonum is a deployed one. It is a progenitor. So the deployed Solanum stenotonum was hybridized with some other unknown species, and the F1 had the doubling of chromosomes, so that the cultivated Solanum tuberosum, subspecies tuberosum, and subspecies angiogena are among the what is that one? Actually, here in potato and sweet potato, it is not exactly known whether they are the autotetraploids or allotetraploids. Allotetraploid means that what I said earlier, hybridizing between two species, and the F1 had the doubling of chromosomes. That is the allotetraploid. Autotetraploid means without hybridization, the deployed species itself we have the doubling of the chromosomes naturally. That is autotetraploid. But in the different books, they are reporting differently, especially in potato and sweet potato. Some are saying it is an autotetraploid and some are saying it is an allotetraploid. But anyhow, it is a polyploid. There are triploid species, Solanum demissum, and pentaploid species, Chaucha, Gispeski, and Cactilogum. The diploid Solanum species are the gametophytic, had the gametophytic self-incompatibility, whereas the tetraploids and heptaploids are self-compatible. And the subspecies angiogena produces tubers in short day conditions in hills, and whereas the subspecies tuberosum produces tubers in short day conditions in tropics, long day conditions in hilly areas. And long days promote the halm growth and no tubers. Yes, but tuberization of potato, especially in India, that we have subspecies tuberosum, requires short days for tuber production and long days for flower production. So the potato in India do not produce tubers under long day conditions. Halm means the above ground portion. The above ground portion grow very well in long day conditions, but it will not produce any tubers. For tuber production, the subspecies tuberosum requires short day conditions. For flowering, it requires long day conditions and low temperature. So that the potato breeding station is located in Kufri in Himachal Pradesh, because in summer season there will be long days, at the same time low temperature. So the potato flowers in those conditions, long day conditions plus low temperature. So the potato breeding station in India is located in Kufri, Himachal Pradesh. So and sometimes in plains also we can induce the flowering of the potato by extending the day length during winter season by supplementing the light with artificial lights. So there is one more technique, true potato seed. Generally potato is propagated through tubers. Why can't with seeds? Yeah, potato can also be propagated through seeds, but the disadvantage of true potato seed is we need nursery. First we have to raise nursery, and we have to transplant them into the main field, and in first season it produces very small tubers. That small tubers again we have to plant in the second season, then it produces the large size tubers. That means propagation through seed takes 2 years, I mean 2 seasons, and it is very labor intensive because of the nursery and so many transplantings. So the cultivation of commercial potato crop through true potato seed is not at all economical. And the true potato seed is having the dormancy for 5 to 6 months, and the dormancy can be broken by treating with the GA3, 1500 to 2000 ppm. And earthing up is an important intercultural operation in potato. 1 and 2 months after planting, we have to earth up the plants, because after tuber formation, if you do not do earthing up, the tubers will be exposed to sunlight. When the tubers are exposed to sunlight, and chlorophyll pigment will develop that causes greening, which is a physiological disorder. And the greening is responsible for the development of alkaloid solanin in the potato tubers. That means, you just remember, don't confuse here. Greening is due to exposure to sunlight and development of chlorophyll. Greening is due to chlorophyll. This greening is responsible for the increasing of solanin content. If solanin is more than 20 milligrams, it will become toxic. So solanin is not responsible for greening. greening is due to chlorophyll due to exposure to sunlight. Because of the greening, solanin will form. So to prevent greening, haulm cutting, this is also very important operation in intercultural operation in potato. 15 to 20 days before harvest, we have to cut the hulms. Hulms means the above ground growing portions, the leaves and the shoots. We have to cut them 15 to 20 days before harvest. Generally, why we recommend hulm cutting before harvesting means potato is generally is grown in winter season in the North India, generally planted in October and November, and the harvesting will be in January and February. So by the end of February, when the temperatures rise, the aphid population will increase. The aphids are the vectors of the viral diseases in potato. So when the at the end of cropping season, the time of harvesting, when the temperature rises, the aphids will come and the aphids spread the viral diseases. So to prevent the spread of the viral diseases through aphids, we cut the hulms when the temperature rises at the end of the cropping period, just before the harvesting. So when you cut the hulms, when you cut the shoots and leaves, there will not be any aphid infestation, isn't it? So there is a chemical, copper sulfate, that is used, that is also used, instead of cutting manually the hulms, you can spray the copper sulfate. It will kill the above ground growth portions. And there are some important varieties and crosses you can read from any textbook. And Kufri Swarna is resistant to late blight and fish nematode. Kufri Sheetman, Kufri Deva tolerant to frost. Kufri Sheetman is tolerant to drought also. And Kufri Surya, this is a very important question. In the last 2 to 3 years, this question is appearing every year. Kufri Surya is a high temperature tolerant variety. It can produce tubers at about 25 degrees centigrade. So remember, Surya means sun, isn't it? So it can be grown under high temperature conditions. Just to remember, Surya means sun, automatically high temperature variety. And red skin ones are the Kufri Red, Kufri Sinduri, Kanchan, Lalima and Aruna. Seed plot technique was developed by Dr. Pushkarnath. ETL for aphids, 20 aphids per 100 leaves each, not much problematic. But if the number of aphids is more than 20 per 100 leaves, we have to go for the plant protection measures. And the tubers have dormancy. The tuber dormancy can be broken by 1% thiourea plus 1 ppm GA for 1 hour. And here is the important one. AMA1 gene. AMA1 is Amaranthus albumin 1 gene. This is an Amaranthus gene. And this gene is responsible for the high albumin and protein content. And this gene was transferred through recombinant DNA technology from Amaranthus to potato. From the Amaranthus species, Amaranthus hypochondriacus. The Amaranthus hypochondriacus is having the gene AMA1, Amaranthus albumin 1. This gene was transferred to potato through recombinant DNA technology for increased protein content in the tubers. This is also one of the important questions. So just these are the recently released varieties of potato. They have been released maybe 3 to 4 years, just 3 to 4 years before this, maybe between 2016 and 2020. So these are the varieties. Kufri Neelakanth, it is a purple color variety with the shallow eyes and yellow flesh. The skin color is purple and the flesh color is yellow. Kufri Neelakanth. Kufri Manik, this is a biofortified variety with the red skin color and yellow flesh tuber. We know Kufri Chipsona 1, 2, 3, they are the chip varieties. And this is the French fry variety, Kufri Fryon. And Kufri Chipsona 4, for processing, potato tubers should have high dry matter content. The dry matter content in the potato tuber should be more than 20% for processing. What happens if dry matter content is less and sugar contents are more? When sugars are more, generally while making the chips and the french fries, we have to fry the potato slices. When you fry the potato slices and the sugar content is more, there will be charring of sugars. Melanin content will develop. You might have seen in local made potato chips, sometimes there is a black color mark. In Lays you cannot find. In Lays they take all care. But in locally made potato chips, sometimes you can find black color discoloration. That is due to charring of sugars. That means the sugars burn when you fry the potato slices. If sugars are more, they burn and they produce that black color thing. So that for processing purpose, the potato tubers should have dry matter content more than 20% and they should have less sugar content. and Kufri Sangam. This is GL purpose, means for table purpose and crossing purpose. And this is an important variety, Kufri Thar 1, 2, 3. They are water use efficient potato varieties. Water use efficient means they can tolerate moisture, stress conditions. They can tolerate drought conditions. They can grow with limited available water. So Kufri Thar 1, 2, 3. Remember, recently released varieties, drought tolerant ones. Thar, there is a Thar desert in Rajasthan. Desert means no rain area, very less rain area, like less water available area. So remember like that, Kufri Thar 1, 2, 3. These three are the drought resistant varieties of potato released recently. So vegetable grafting, I have seen the last year JRF question paper. There is a question on vegetable grafting. Vegetable grafting is done against what? Soil-borne diseases or airborne diseases or something like that, options are there. So I have included here the vegetable grafting. What are the purposes of the vegetable grafting? When you use a rootstock, you know, you all know no grafting. How do we do grafting? There are two questions in grafting. There is a rootstock and there is a scion. We join the scion with the rootstock. Rootstock is the lower portion. It produces roots into the ground. Where the scion is the above portion, it produces the flowers and fruits, right? So the rootstock effect is there. When during grafting, you can improve the yield and quality. Quality means improving in the nutrient contents, protein content, and new vitamin content. So the rootstock effect is there on the scion in increasing the yield and quality. We will see the examples. Stress resistance. What type of diseases can we solve through grafting? The diseases are the soil-borne diseases. Because here the rootstock is the resistant one. Rootstock is the resistant one, and rootstock produces roots, and rootstock is connected to the soil. So when you use a disease-resistant rootstock and a susceptible high-yielding scion, you can produce high yield without the problem of the disease. The scion is high-yielding type but susceptible to disease, but the rootstock is a wild type but it is resistant to disease. So you graft it, take the rootstock from the wild and scion from the cultivated high yielding type, you can get higher yield without much loss due to disease. So soil grafting is very effective against soil borne diseases like fusarium wheat and bacteria. This was the question last time. Grafting was good against which type of diseases? Soil borne diseases. Examples, fusarium wheat and bacterial wheat. At the same time, grafting is also useful against abiotic stresses like low temperature, heat, drought, flooding. It's actually these three: drought, flooding, and salinity occurs in the soil, isn't it? Drought, flood, and salinity. All these three conditions are related to the soil condition. So that when the rootstock is tolerant to these conditions, you can grow the, you can graft the susceptible scion to the tolerant rootstock, and you can get good higher yields without the problem of the stress. And inducing flowering, grafting can be used to induce the flower. So sweet potato cultivar, this I will talk in next slide. So sex modification, this also I will talk in next slide. Sex modification means generally in case of monoecious types, no sorry, in dioecious types, male and female plants are different. In case of sweet gourd, spine gourd and pointed gourd, 10% male plants we have to plant in the field to induce flowering. Isn't it? So these 10% plants are waste. They occupy the land but they do not produce any fruits. These 10% male plants. But what happens when you graft a female scion onto this male parent, it produces the lower portion of the stalk, produces the male flowers, and the female scion produces the female flowers. So that you can convert this unproductive 10% male plants also into productive. So here are the examples. Yield improvement was done in potato scion Kufri Sindhuri and the tomato rootstock Pusa Ruby. Yield increased in the scion cultivar. Oh, sorry, it is the mistake. Excuse me. The rootstock is potato and the scion is tomato. I'm very sorry, I didn't see it earlier. So yeah, disease resistance, the rootstock, disease resistant rootstocks are in brinjal, Solanum integrifolium and Solanum torvum. These two are the wild species. Solanum integrifolium, a wild species resistant to fusarium wheat. Solanum torvum, wild species resistant to bacterial wheat. When you use these two wild species as the rootstocks, we can overcome the fusarium wheat and bacterial wheat in brinjal. Abiotic stress resistance also, by using the raw rootstocks like Solanum melongena and Solanum hebrotheates, we can overcome the stress problems. And quality improvement, in case of tomato, a hybrid rootstock, Solanum lycopersicum and Solanum cheesemanii, this hybrid rootstock can be used in tomato for improving the quality, like total acidity and TSS content. And flower induction, especially these tropical tuber crops, when flowering is very problem in tropical tuber crops. So by grafting onto a flowering cultivar inducer, we can induce flowering also in non-flowering types. And as I told earlier, modification of sex form in Momotica cochinchinensis, by inducing the female flowers on male plants, by grafting the males, female scion, we can convert the 10% unproductive male plants to also female plants. So just remember the exams, the brinjal rootstocks are very important, Solanum integrifolium and Solanum torvum. Solanum integrifolium rootstock resistance against Fusarium wilt and Solanum torvum resistance against bacterial wilt. These rootstocks are very important. Classic examples they ask. I think in IRI PhD examination we have asked this question. So effect of temperature. There are different effects of temperatures, like tomato lycopene content requires 21 to 24 degrees centigrade, about 27 below 10 temperature, the lycopene development will be affected. Likewise, no, I have noted here the temperature effect of almost all crops. You can take these slides and you can read these notes I prepared. What are the effects of temperature on crops, like in chili, fruit set and fruit drop occurs at 40 degrees centigrade. In brinjal, if temperature is less than 50 degrees centigrade, the growth will affect. And in cucumber, muskmelon, watermelon, in muskmelon and watermelon, cool nights and warm days are required for the accumulation of sugar. That is very important. And in bitter gourd, short days plus low temperature 20 degrees centigrade promote female flowers, whereas male flowers increase if the temperature is above 40 degrees centigrade. Pea and cowpea, French bean. French bean blossom drop and ovule abortion occurs when temperature is above 35 degrees centigrade. Okra flower drop occurs at 40 degrees centigrade. And in potato is important. Night temperature less than or equal to 20 degrees centigrade is very essential for tuberization in potato, and the short days also required. If temperature is more than 21 degrees centigrade, tuberization affected, stops at 29 to 30 degrees centigrade, and the curing 20 degrees centigrade. So here are the effect of some growth regulators on vegetable crops. In tomato, this is very important. The seed treatment with 240 to 5 p.m. increase the fruit set and parthenocarpy. And in chili, it prevents fruit drop when you spray NAA 50 ppm and tricontinal. And cucumber, you speak here for just 2 to 3 minutes. Generally, gynoecious lines have female flowers. So when gynoecious lines have female flowers, how do we maintain them? There are no male flower in gynoecious line. So how do we maintain this? Just 1 minute. So we have to induce male flowers on the gynoecious lines. So when the male flower is induced on the gynoecious lines, so that we can pollinate the male and female flowers and we can produce the gynoecious lines again. So how do we induce male flowers on a gynoecious line for maintenance? We have to spray GA3 1500 ppm or GA4 plus GA5 50 to 100 ppm and silver nitrate 200 to 300 ppm. So when you spray these chemicals on a gynoecious line, it produces male flowers. So you cross the male and female flowers and you can again produce the gynoecious line. So the maintenance of gynoecious line by spraying of these chemicals is very, very important. Every time this question will come. And in case of cucurbits, we spray all the growth regulators at 2 to 4 leaf stage. That also you remember. Likewise, in watermelon, inhibition of male flowers, and to promote more number of female flowers, we have to spray Teva and boron. Bottle guard also for the same purpose, boron 3 ppm, calcium 5 ppm. I will give you the slides and you can read from the slides in the other crops. So in production, I have not given much about the production technology here. You can go through the two books I have referred here, Vegetable Tuber Crops and Spices by Thumbraj and Vegetable Science and Technology in India by Vishnu Swarup. Because generally different textbooks give different figures for seed rates, spacings, so that you will get confused. So just refer these two books. These two books are the popular and most commonly followed books. So whatever the seed rate and the spacing given in these books, you just follow them. Generally, hybrid seed rate is less than in open pollinated seed rate. And the seed rate varies between seasons. In case of pea, the seed rate is high in early season. In summer season, the seed rate is high in okra. Spacing is less in legumes, more in cucurbits. So you prepare a table for all the crops. Seed rate, fertilizer, no need to read the fertilizer doses. But you remember, the fertilizer nitrogen is very less required in nitrogen fixing legumes. Just see about it. In nitrogen fixing legumes, we give less nitrogen fertilizer. So there you take care. Harvesting, there are different harvesting indices. At a particular stage, we have to harvest the fruit. So when we harvest the fruits, so cucumber, when the skin color turns dark green, in muskmelon, there are two in muskmelon, full sleep stage and half sleep stage. In full sleep stage, we harvest for local market, and for half sleep stage, we harvest for the long distance market. In case of watermelon, when you tap the watermelon, it produces dull sound and the tingles dry. And the ground spot where the watermelon fruit touches the ground, that turns to yellow. These are the harvesting of watermelon. These are important. Watermelon harvesting indices are very, very important. Bottle guard, if you pierce the fruit with nail, no, it goes easily, you can harvest it. No, it was better guard from King Ashok. Tomato, here again, the red ripe fruits are harvested for local market and processing. Mature green and pink color fruits are harvested for long distance market and storage. Grading, tomato fruits are having four grades based on the shape and color, super A, super fancy and commercial. In case of potato, grading is done based on size and based on purpose. For based on size, it's small, less than 25 grams, medium 20 to 25 to 50 grams, large 50 to 75 grams and extra large greater than 75 grams. And based on purpose, for dehydration, the tuber should have 3 cm diameter. For making french fries, the tuber should have 5 cm diameter. For chips, 4 to 6 cm diameter, and for canning, 3 to 5 cm diameter. And storage temperatures, you can read the storage temperature, but here I will tell about one thing. Potato, table potato, table means for edible purpose, the making curry and some other thing. Table potato can be stored at low temperature, 2.2 to 3.3 degrees centigrade. For the processing potato, should not be stored at low temperatures, because at low temperatures, there is a conversion of starch into sugars. So at low temperature, if starch are converted into sugar, and you use that tuber for making the chips or french fry something, the burning sugars will burn and that charring will happen. So the processing potato is stored at 10 to 12 degrees centigrade. Table potato is stored at 2.2 to 3.3 degrees centigrade. This difference you observe. So just I will give very brief about biotechnology, very brief. So meristem culture, generally we go for the elimination of viruses. So in onion, shallot, pea and brinjal, for the elimination of different viruses, meristem culture is followed. Anther culture for the development of homozygous lines. So from anthers are N, not 2N, not N, pollen grains. Pollen grains are N, not 2N, haploids. So when you grow the pollen grains in a culture medium, they produce haploid plants. And to make them diploid, you have to double the chromosomes by giving the calcium treatment. So that 100% homozygous plants we can get from the anther culture. As I told earlier, in chili, in capsicum fruticans, Haihua 3 variety was developed for anther culture. Embryo rescue, when in distant hybridization, when two wild species are crossed, two species are crossed, there is generally a failure of the cross due to hybridization barriers. In case of, if the hybridization barrier is embryo abortion, we can take out the immature embryo and we can culture them on the tissue culture media and we can grow it into a plantlet. So these are the crosses where embryo rescue is used. Somatic hybridization is different here. Two different cells, we put in a test tube, we add a fusogen, and we fuse two cells of two different varieties or two different species. So here the cells of two different species, Solana melangina and integrifolia melangina and Saint Croix sativa, are fused for obtaining the resistant to Pseudomonas. So here the important thing is broccoli to cauliflower. transfer of CMS Bugra. In my next class, I will talk about this process. But you remember this one, broccoli to cauliflower, the cytoplasmic male sterility was transferred through somatic hybridization. In potato also, in tomato also. So transgenic viral resistance. So engineering, through genetic engineering, we have developed the varieties that are resistant to viral diseases. The transgenic product is mostly a viral coat protein. Like this viral coat protein gene, when you introduce this viral coat protein gene into a plant, the plant host plant resistance will be there. So the binding sites will be blocked by this viral coat protein, so that when the actual virus comes, there will not be any binding site. For more information, you just read the book. Now we don't have much time, so this concept I cannot explain right now. You can contact me for any clarification regarding the concepts. So these are the examples where the vegetables are engineered for viral resistance. And likewise for fungal resistance also. These genes, chitinase, the mechanism of fungal resistance is degradation of fungal cell wall. We all know that fungal cell wall is made up of chitin, isn't it? So the fungal cell wall is made up of chitin. So when you transfer this chitinase gene, it will degrade the fungal cell wall. Automatically, the fungus will die. Likewise, osmotin. Osmotin means it will make the fungus dehydrate. Fungus will not get much water. Likewise. So these are the examples. Bacterial resistance also. The BT insect also. The BT insect again from the bacteria, soil-borne bacteria, Bacillus thuringiensis. So you all know what is BT, how it works. No? So the mechanism, I don't go much deeper. So the BT vegetables are developed here. Cry1 AB against Helicobacter armigera in tomato. Cry1 H in sweet corn against same Helicobacter armigera. Cry3A against Leptinotarsa disseminata. No, the cabbage, diamondback moth, Plutellagia elastella, and against cabbage butterfly. So these are the BT genes transferred into vegetables against various insect resistance. So what is the synthetic BT? So this GY1AB is similar to Cry1AB, but it is not directly taken from the bacteria. The sequence of the gene synthesized in the lab. So this is synthetic BT. The gene sequence is same, but the gene sequence is not taken from the bacteria. The gene sequence is artificially synthesized in the laboratory. That is synthetic BT, nothing but. So in brinjal, tomato, cabbage, but unfortunately none of these transgenic varieties are allowed for cultivation in India. As I told earlier, the BT brinjal was allowed for commercial cultivation in Bangladesh 4 to 5 years ago. They have been successfully cultivating BT brinjal and harvesting, and farmers are having good profit. So far, no side effect, adverse effect on human health or environment has been reported. It may be there in the long time, may not be in short time, but in long time. Actually, this BT is always a very debatable topic. Some people are opposing, some people support that. Until and unless there is a strong scientific evidence, we cannot support anything. So gene transferred other than BT, these are the genes from some anti-nutrient factors from the other crops transferred to the different crops. These anti-nutrient factors also sometimes they provide resistance against insects. That is what we call antibiosis. For example, gossypol content in cotton provide repel the insects. Likewise, with the sinigrin content in the brassica vegetables, it repel the insects, the diamondback moth. So the anti-nutrient and alkalines present in the plants, they repel the insects. That is what we call antibiosis. So this antibiosis genes also transferred to the one crop to another crop for providing resistance. So the proteinase inhibitor, trypsin inhibitor. So when the insect eats, the insect will not get protein. Proteinase inhibitor, the insect will not get protein. Likewise. So all trypsin inhibitor also protease inhibitor. So engineering for herbicide tolerance, why it is needed? So generally, when the herbicide is spread, it kills the crop plant also. Along with the weed, it kills the crop plant also. So when the crop is resistant to herbicide, the crop will not die, only the weed will die. So these are the herbicide resistant genes that are transferred to various crops against various herbicides like atrazin, bromoxin, and L-phosphenothrycin. So engineer for post harvest traits, especially in tomato, that long, as I told earlier, fruits and vegetables have very less shelf life. So we have to increase the shelf life of these fruits and vegetables. So how we can increase it? So we by slowing the ripening process, we can increase the shelf life of the vegetables. So all these genes, antisense, polyglutaminase, ACC synthase, and ACC oxidase synthase, phytosynthase genes, these genes are, these enzymes, actually ACC synthase and ACC oxidase are enzymes in the ethylene pathway. So ethylene is a ripening hormone. Ethylene is responsible for the ripening. So these genes are, these enzymes are in the ethylene biosynthesis pathway. So by blocking the genes of ACC synthase and ACC oxidase, we can block the ethylene production, and we can slow the ripening, and we can increase the shelf life. So this is the very important slide. Those are the concepts only. What are the varieties developed by the private sector in India by transgenic means? Not only in India, all the worldwide. So Flavosavr, you know that antisense technology they used for increasing the shelf life in tomato, like Colgene company, and for quality improving in tomato, the endless summer variety. And Colorado potato beetle resistance in potato, the variety is New Leaf. And the same Colorado potato beetle resistance in potato black jacket and viral resistance in squash Freedom 2. This Freedom 2 was the previous question. What is the viral resistant squash transgenic variety Freedom 2? So just go through this slide. And thank you for your patience listening. I think I might have probably been boring. So anyhow, don't worry. And in our next class, I will provide some information on general classification also. My next class. And thank you, sir. Thank you for giving me the opportunity. Anybody is there?
Yeah, thank you so much.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, nice coverage. You have long spell, you have nicely begin, and I was also listening.
Sir.
And it's a very excellent lecture. I think you have completely covered to the point. And I think students, they have understood very nicely. I'll ask the students if they have any questions, any queries. Dear students, if you have any questions, you can ask the sir. Pragati? Yeah, there is a good comment. They are saying very informative. What is the doubt? Toko Nile, you just ask the doubt. Toko? Toko Nile?
Oh, we have to unmute her.
Okay, I'll unmute you. Just a minute, I will give that. Now you can unmute yourself.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Good evening, sir. Sir, my doubt is like, sir, the summer squash, like, is it also used for the batting sponge? It was written in one of the book. Sir, I can't hear you.
You please unmute yourself.
Yeah, I have also seen it in some textbook. They have written summer squash is also used for bathing purpose. But generally, the question comes related to sponge guard only. Sponge guard is generally used for bathing purpose, the sponge inside the fruit. So this is based on the options. You see the options, what are the options there? And based on the option, you can answer the question. Yeah, I have seen somewhere they mentioned summer squash also.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. And sir, one more is there, sir. Like regarding this one, the legume crops, like they are generally grown as a one-season vegetable crop.
Yeah.
The exception is the peas.
Yeah.
And in your slide, it's written Dolichos bean. But in one of the book, it's given peas and broad beans. So I'm confused about this.
Yeah, broad bean. Broad bean can tolerate low temperature up to 4 degrees centigrade. But Dalicas bean, the garden bean, Labla purpureus variety typicus, that is a cool season crop.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
No, one more thing. No, generally, I think you just check the textbook. I told you two textbooks. One is Vegetable Tuber Crop Spices by Thambraj, and another one Vegetable Crops in India by Vishnu Swarup. So if you get any doubt, you just refer these two textbooks. Generally, in objective books, no, there will be a lot of confusions and mistakes in the objective books. If you read directly those objective books like Instant Horticulture or something else, no, there will be a lot of confusion,
sir.
And there will be a lot of confusion and mistake. Whenever you get confused, you refer textbook. So the objective books are written by generally some students who got some JRF that notes they publish as a book. So better you read textbook whenever you get a doubt.
Sir, actually, it's due to lockdown, like the library is also closed.
Yeah, yes.
So
yes,
I only have that D.D. Singh book, and even there is lots of mistakes is there, and I'm so confused with like, I'm having trust issue with myself right now, like because of so many mistakes in Glossars, B.D. Singh and Instant. And
for me,
I'm referring the Glossars and B.D. Singh for the vegetables.
Yes, yes.
As there is no other option for me.
No problem. You can mail me or you can contact me if you get any doubt. And not only you, anybody, all you can contact me. So I can refer and I can clarify your doubts. No problem.
And sir, regarding the here the toxic substance present in the vegetable.
Yes.
Sir, in your slides for the soybean, the toxic substance was given as saponin, but in the Glossars and other MCQ, sir, it is given as trypsin inhibitor.
Yeah. In the soybean, trypsin inhibitor is also there. Yeah, I forgot to mention. Yes, yes. Trypsin inhibitor is also there in soybean. That's correct.
Okay. And sir, last final doubt, like regarding the cool crops, okay, cool season vegetable.
Yeah.
Like, I'm so confused about this one. Like, generally in the this one, cool crops, there is two types. The annual type is there and the biennial type is there.
Okay.
Sir, for all the early varieties, sir, they are annual type, and for all the late varieties, sir, they are biennial type, right?
Yes.
So, sir, this one in the annual type, do they require vernalization temperature?
Generally, this annual, biennial, we classified based on purpose. The annual type means we harvest it when the curd forms or when the head forms, we harvest it and we make it annual. So, if you allow that crop without harvesting, no? It will produce flowers, so it will become biennial. So I will clear it in my next class. I will talk about the cool season crops, no?
Yes, sir.
Then I will tell you.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Anything else? Anybody?
Oh, they were asking in the chat box.
They want the slides.
It is there in the. Okay, he will provide the notes as per our agreement and.
Yeah, sure. I will provide notes also. Yeah.
Any other questions? Okay, so thank you so much. From our College of Horticulture and Forestry, we profusely thank for your sparing your valuable time and educating our students. Thank you so much.
It's my pleasure.
Thank you.